Outstanding. Hey, well, welcome everybody. I know we'll probably get a few more ads here as the day goes on, but I want to obviously just thank everybody for carving out time. I know everybody's super busy and there's a lot of things kind of going on these days, but I think it's also important to make sure that we're staying connected with our.
Oops,
lost your voice.
There we go. Somebody muted me. All right. So now, again, I think it's just important for us to make sure that we stay connected with our peers, our colleagues, with our UNM community. And with a lot of us being based in NorCal, I think this is a great opportunity to not only know, like we just talked about with Carlos being in San Mateo, I'm based in San Ramon and East Bay. I know Irene's also South Bay. It's good for us to make sure that we understand like where we are, we can continue that sense of community, even away from obviously Albuquerque and the home base. But the main reason that we're here is we also want to hear from our new Dean of the Anderson School of Management. Her name is Dean Mitzi Montoya. So Dean, thank you so much for joining us. I know there's a lot that we're going to talk about in terms of updates of what you're driving and your vision for Anderson. And then we also have an exciting panel of speakers that are going to talk about, you know, what are they doing currently in the Silicon Valley, right, as we call it, and a lot of the things that kind of relate to how we're going to tie back to supporting Anderson and their mission. So hopefully you'll see on your screen now, a poll did just pop up. We want to make sure that you answer this one at the beginning and that we will have one towards the end. So if you see the question there, it just says, hey, did you attend ASM or is your degree from another part of UNM? And hopefully it's a very simple one. You got two choices there. And I know myself, I'm an Anderson grad. I got my undergrad in marketing and international management. So hopefully we'll give it just a few more seconds. Make sure everybody, we need a few more folks to respond. And we'll kind of leave it for there, right? So we've got roughly about 50-50 split-ish. So we do have good Anderson representation. So Dean Montoya, you can be proud that we have a lot of relevant audience here. So with that being said, I wanted to also just kind of see, let me just double check participants, because I wanted to see if any of the rest of our alumni team had jumped on. So like I said, they had not yet, although they were going to at some point. So when Connie Beamer, she's the executive director of the UNM Alumni Association, as well as Chad Cooper. He's the UNM Alumni Association board president. So if they do come on at some point, maybe we'll kind of pause and give them a chance to say a few things as it relates to things that are going on within the Alumni Association. But that said, I think this is a good time for us to pivot. So I do want to introduce now Dean Montoya. So welcome, Dean. I know to start us off, I really want to just kind of, I know the audience wants to hear more about you. You know, can you tell us a little bit about yourself? And then also just kind of start describing your personal journey. You know, what have you done in your career that's ultimately led you to UNM and to Anderson?
Well, thank you, Antonio, and thank you very much for getting this idea off the ground and helping coordinate. And thanks to everyone else that has helped do this. It is nice to be here. Nice to meet you all virtually. Once we're traveling again, of course, my hope is to come up to Northern California and be able to see people in person. We are starting to travel again, actually, and I have a trip to Southern California in planning, and I'm planning one already for Northern California. So we'll keep you posted. We'll work on doing something to get together. It's been a strange startup journey, as you might imagine, but I feel now like a Zoom native in that I interviewed and accepted this job and joined UNM entirely via Zoom. And I've met a few of my coworkers, but not many of them. But the silver lining is, and the reason that's all okay, is as it turns out, after 25 years as a researcher, what I do is finally relevant. I study virtual teams. So that's what I've been studying for the last 25 years. And although primarily virtual R&D, and in particular in 3D virtual environments. But so it is convenient that I feel like I was at least well-schooled on the topic since I've been studying it for the last 25 years. So that was kind of cool. A little bit about me, where I come from. I hail from Fort Worth, Texas originally, but I did not grow up there. My grandparents are from New Mexico, hence the last name, and those of you who may be my long lost cousins. So my dad's parents are from New Mexico, and though they moved out of New Mexico before he was born. So I went to 9 different schools before I graduated high school. I finished high school up in Northern Michigan, and from there went to Michigan State University on a scholarship. I was very grateful to have the opportunity to go to school on a scholarship. And I did an undergraduate degree in engineering. So I'm a general engineer by background and went to work in the automotive industry as a design engineer, which I did not enjoy at all. And so promptly went back to school with the intent of getting an MBA, which I did not finish. So I ended up having a grad assistantship working for a professor who ultimately became my advisor in a PhD program. He recruited me into the PhD program. So I did a PhD in marketing and statistics. And from there, made my way to North Carolina State University. So I spent 15 years at NC State in Research Triangle Park. Loved it. It was amazing. Had 2 boys there. My boys are now 27 and 23. So I have, that's been useful as keeping a pulse on this age that I work with, who never age. Our students are perennially 18 to 25 years old. So that's been fun. My older son now works at Arizona State University, which is where I went after NC State. I was at ASU for 5 years, where I was Dean of the College of Technology and Innovation and Vice Provost of the Polytechnic Campus. So those of you in California, you're familiar with Cal Poly. And so we essentially built a Cal Poly inside ASU. So that's what the Polytechnic campus was and the College of Technology and Innovation, a very much a project-based learn by doing type approach to education. And ultimately merged that into a large engineering school where I became the inaugural vice president of entrepreneurship and innovation for ASU and mainly ran our investments in startup community and supporting the advancement of entrepreneurship education in a cross-cutting way across all colleges and schools. That was a great experience, but I missed my business school roots. So I took a job at Oregon State University. I see we have an Oregon Duck on the call, I'm guessing, hence the big O. So I took a job working for the Beavs, and I was there for 4 years as dean of the business school in a very small town in the rainy, lovely, green, moss-covered Pacific Northwest, which was beautiful. But I also then was continuing to look for my next opportunity to make a difference and contribute. At Oregon State, I led the university's entrance into Portland. We had really not operated in Portland at all historically. So I opened our facility there and was the executive dean for engineering and business. So again, really working on my connection with engineering and focused on economic development and advancement in the state, mainly focused around advanced manufacturing. I went to Washington State University, which for those who don't know where that is, it's on the way east side of the state, right on the border of Idaho. And it's not at all like the west side of the state. So it is a very small college town. It was beautiful. I went there as provost, and I was in that role for a very brief time before finding this opportunity. And this is such a perfect fit because I was very much so looking to come back to the Southwest. I love the opportunity that UNM represents, and I am especially grateful to have the honor of serving in this role. And I see just incredible potential for UNM to really move to the next level. And we're a very good business school. And I think we have the potential to be a great business school, a national model of what it means to educate an amazing, diverse student body and really contribute to regional development. So I'm extremely excited about that. And I'm back close again to family. So I have a lot of family in Arizona and Colorado and Texas still. So this is nice to be basically in the middle and easily access everybody, which is perfect because I've just taken up a new hobby of camping. So with my new camper, which is a Winnebago, whose name is Wilma. And so we are going to tour New Mexico this summer. And then the last answer to an important question, red or green, I'm Christmas and cat or dog, straight up cats. So there you go.
Oh, those were the two questions for the end. So
yeah. I know that was, I just want to get them out of the way.
Sounds good. I'm sure for everybody else, I hope that it's the same. Christmas should be the default. Like you just cannot choose one over the other. So maybe we switch to the next question, Mitzi Montoya. I know if we're kind of deep diving now to Anderson, what I heard is a lot of your career, you've kind of had a balance of an innovation focus, how to partner in terms of economic development. You've had perspectives all around the country. Where does that kind of tie in terms of your vision for Anderson now at this point? You know, is there some sort of niche, a competitive advantage that you're kind of thinking of bringing a lot of those learnings together? How do we now kind of put that into place at Anderson?
So a great question. I think that I've had an opportunity to learn and live in different regions of the country that have in different ways faced the challenges that I think we face in New Mexico and the need for business development and regional economic development. One of the things that excites me about UNM is that really the leadership role that I think Anderson can play in contributing to the advancement of the state. And I think we have a really important, not just a role there, but a responsibility. And so that's exciting work because, and I think the business school should be at the forefront of that because we speak the language of business. We can and should partner to develop programs that are of need. And the thing from a niche standpoint, that's really unique and exciting to me that I saw from the outside in and has been true in spades since arriving. We are one of a kind in the nation as a business school. And I shared this with the faculty at faculty meetings, and it's been interesting listening to their reaction because I think this faculty just does naturally something that in fact is extremely unique. And the one of a kind is that we are the only out of about 4,000 colleges and universities in this country, we're the only one that's a flagship research intensive university that is as diverse as we are. And you let that settle for a minute. That's really special. Mm-hmm. And it's something that is a story we haven't told, and it's a natural defensible strength that we have a lot of opportunity to do some real good with. So for example, all of the companies out there that are concerned about and really care about beyond talking about diversifying their workforce, we are an authentic provider of that at a very high caliber level. We play in the realm of top equally qualified and high quality business programs. And we produce amazing talent. You all are great examples of that. And many of whom wants to go elsewhere and many of whom want to stay at home. And those are all good things. And those two things can be combined to help both grow business in New Mexico and produce talent for the globe, wherever people want to go work. And so it's a real natural strength that in my view, what I said from day one is I aspire to be a national model of a business school that produces diverse talent at the highest quality level of programs. But I say that because we already are. We just need to tell that story and then act on that and engage with partners that want to work with us to really tell that story and to produce what's needed in a range of different programs. So I'm extremely excited about that. And I see that as a great strength. And we also have great bench strength in that we have faculty who, of course, are fantastic in their respective disciplines, from accounting to marketing to finance, but who also are excellent researchers who study, in fact, the way in which our characteristics and how and why diversity makes business better. We have people who study that and know this and are the top of their field. And so you put those two things together, we have a lot to teach other business schools and companies. So that's exciting to me as one of those sort of just untapped natural assets that we have a potential to differentiate ourselves around. And the other would be what else is here, which is the national labs that are here and the partnership opportunities that represents being a border state, and especially with reshoring that we're going to see with supply chains now. We have a lot of opportunity to participate in things that are just naturally advantageous for the state of New Mexico.
Outstanding. So I'm excited certainly by a lot of those things that you highlighted. I hope the rest of the audience is. Maybe now's a good time to just bring in some of our other panelists that also want to kind of talk and highlight about certain things. We have some exciting questions that are queued up and ready to go. So we really appreciate your update, Dean Montoya. For this next part, we want to focus on two specific topics. And the first one is, what happens when UNM Anderson students migrate to other parts of the country? And in this case, we want to kind of focus on Northern California and Silicon Valley. So we want to certainly bring up a few of our panelists now. So let's make sure, Irene, if you can help bring some of those folks on.
I think we're all spotlighted.
Outstanding.
Do we need Crystal right now too, or?
Not yet.
Okay. We're all here.
That'll be coming up. Outstanding. Thank you. Thank you for the panelists. I really appreciate you joining. So I want to make sure and just have you introduce yourselves, and then we'll want to make sure and understand your connection to Anderson, and just share a little bit about your postgraduate journey. Maybe what brought you to Northern California now, or you know, as part of your journey to get there at some point. So I'll start off with Irene.
Hi everyone, I'm Irene Lefton, and I graduated from UNM with a BA in economics and an MBA from Anderson in 1980-1981 in a program called the 3-2 program. And I had worked in our family business in Albuquerque while I was in school, and I moved to Los Angeles after I got my MBA. And my time there was spent developing my career and mostly in large companies. I worked for Transamerica Insurance. I worked for Price Waterhouse. And in those roles, I migrated towards software and software development and professional services. And I was involved with the Alumni Association. Gary and I were both part of the LA chapter. And I migrated towards Silicon Valley in the mid-90s, 1996. And I joined the NorCal chapter, and I stepped into leadership roles here pretty quickly. And I love staying connected to UNM and meeting other alumni. For the last 20 years, I've been working at and advising startups. So I had my big company part of my career, and now I work in very entrepreneurial early stage companies, a variety of types and sizes and a variety of roles. Most of the last 10 years on the executive staff at a VP level. And now I work in an emerging field called customer success, and I'm consulting, and I'm writing a book that I'm wrapping up that should be published later this year, which is about the economics of customer-centric businesses. So it kind of brings my economics and business all together. So it's been a journey, and I really treasure what I learned at UNM and Anderson that set me up to have a lot of fun and a successful career, and landed me here in Silicon Valley, loving the ability to stay connected to UNM and Anderson.
Outstanding. I told Irene, as soon as she finishes that book, I'm going to be the first one to buy it, and hopefully she signed it. So thank you, Irene. Why don't we switch gears to Manny? Manny, do you want to introduce yourself? And same thing, just share a quick background on your journey.
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. Good to see you. Thanks for joining. Thanks, Antonio. So I grew up in Carlsbad, New Mexico, and navigated up to UNM and graduated in 1985 from the Anderson School. So yes, and that's forever ago. I know that. So look at all the gray hair. But after that, I took a job. I had interned at PNM in their IT group, worked there for a couple years, and a software company approached me and said, hey, would you be interested in moving out to California? There's a job opening in the Silicon Valley. And I thought, Silicon Valley, what would I want to go there? What's there? I said, I'll go to LA. I said, if you want me to go, I'll go to LA. That's where we always went as a family. We drove the station wagon LA to go to Disneyland and SeaWorld. But why would I go to this Silicon Valley place? And they just said, well, we don't have an opening in LA. It's in up in San Francisco. I'm like, no, don't want it. And they said, well, why don't you just come out and interview and just come out, because we could probably work something out. You can work from LA. And I can tell you, by the time I flew in and saw the place, when I flew back, and I thought, I would be crazy to live in LA versus Northern California. I knew like that exactly where I needed to be. So I had already made up my mind when I flew out there, there's no way I'm going to LA. I'm going to work from there. So 1988, I moved out to Silicon Valley, and literally have been on the peninsula here working in the valley since then. going from the different iterations of the technology that we went from, like starting off with mainframe and then client server. I mean, I literally live like 2 miles away from Oracle, their old headquarters. I heard they moved their headquarters now to Texas, but the big buildings are still around. But we transitioned from the client server down to, I mean, we went through all that stuff and I've stayed here and it's just, it's been a blast. So I've really enjoyed it. And I still have deep connections. My mom is in Albuquerque Brothers and such. So I have this passion now that I really want to push out to the UNM community, just what a different world it is here in Silicon Valley and the opportunities here. There's a reason people come here from all over the globe, right? Because they know what's going on here. And the transition into here has just been super easy. And Dean Montoya, one of the things you said is, you know, the ability to have these kids work here and create the tighter relationship. There's so much opportunity here. And so would love to discuss with you and with UNM to see what we can do to help you achieve some of the goals that you have. But again, thanks for joining everyone. And I'm glad to be here.
Very good. Thank you, Manny. Excited to hear all your New Mexico connections still, but you know, I think it'd be good. We can get some of those folks to come visit us in the Bay Area. That'd be awesome too. All right, I want to switch to our final panelist. So Sierra, do you want to introduce yourself? Same thing, a little bit of your journey.
Yeah, hi everyone. I'm Sierra Martinez. I am a New Mexico girl through and through, raised in Taos, New Mexico, the daughter of an artist in my father, and my mother was the brains behind the business. So entrepreneurial runs deep in my veins throughout my entire family. I went to Albuquerque, to UNM for my undergrad and grad school. I got my undergrad in entrepreneurial studies and my graduate degree in marketing, which I really appreciated the hands-on approach that Anderson took as opposed to just memorizing for me. So from there, I, you know, kind of fell into athletics, if you will, and started interning and quickly started working for the Lobo Club. Spent about 5-ish and some change years there, and then went on to Presbyterian Healthcare Foundation and really enjoyed some time there doing development work and fundraising, and just broadening the network and really being deep in the community in New Mexico. So from there, I got married, and my husband is actually who brought me to the Bay Area. He got a job at University of California, Berkeley, in the athletic department. And so we moved out here a few years ago, and it really was such a great opportunity for myself because, as I believe, my first entrepreneurial wish as a child was to start an ice cream truck for dogs. While I'm not doing that, it finally gave me the boost to branch out from the corporate world, if you will, and start my own business. So I now have a creative agency, which is flourishing. And I just am so, so deeply passionate about it. Again, connecting me back to my roots with my parents, so.
Outstanding, thank you, Sierra. I wanna just kind of keep going off of that, because our next question is more about like an entrepreneurial mindset, right? And like giving you starting and having that courage to take that leap to start your own agency. Tell us a little bit about your mindset that you need to be successful, especially in a very competitive place like Silicon Valley.
Yeah. So, you know, it's funny when I talk back to my parents and my entrepreneurial childhood and how that has been ingrained in me throughout my entire family, it's pretty understandable why my husband says that I am he calls me a constant observer, because I am constantly observing everything around me. And that's just how I was raised. But now being here in the Bay, it's like you're constantly looking for everything and observing everything. And I think that that is the onset to that entrepreneurial mindset, right? So for instance, I love learning about businesses, whether they're in my industry or not my industry, but seeing how they succeed, how do they fail? How do they lead? How do they tell their story? How do they run their finances? What do they do? And here in the Bay, and in Silicon Valley, there's so many great examples of that. You know, being aware of the world from a creative perspective, this offers so much here, because there's, you know, the architecture, the art itself, the the shapes, the colors, you're just constantly looking and observing everything again. So I think, you know, identifying everything around you all the time and having that mindset goes hand in hand. But what I've realized really is that the Bay Area and Silicon Valley itself are home to this heightened level of innovation and motivation. And being that, like you mentioned, Antonio, that the Bay is so competitive, right? It pushes you though, because you have to stay on the edge of your market all the time. Yet at the same time, there's so many doors that open. And what I've learned and realized in just even my short time being here is that even connections from New Mexico set me up on a world of open doors here, and taking every open door and seeing where it leads me. And even if it closes, you get back up and you take the next door. So it's really that entrepreneurial mindset of starting a business here has been so inspirational, because there's so many great stories around you and so many resources and connections. But it also really is the drive and the push to continue getting better, to continue improving, and to continue developing your skill set in whatever it is you're doing, whether that's your own business or if you're in a different business. Because while we may lack, you know, New Mexican cuisine here, we certainly don't lack talent here. So you have to be constantly getting better and being motivated to do so.
Outstanding. Thank you. I can plus one on that. Like, I'm dying for any New Mexico food. We need to like start something up here.
I hear you.
Manny, switching gears, same question to you. If you're thinking about, you know, the many years that you've been here in the Bay Area and seeing a lot of companies evolve and come and go, you know, what do you think is like more of maybe not an entrepreneurial, but even an intrapreneurial mindset to be successful, you know, in your careers?
Yeah, I appreciate that. I don't know if I had the entrepreneurial skills or thoughts like what Jera had initially. But the one area I think you can't be here 30 years and not pick it up, right? Or you're not going to be successful. You're living in the middle of it. So it's definitely evolved. But I would say the one of the big things that I think really that I was good at, that Anderson helped me with, was the problem solving skills. And if you think about problem solving, then you can start navigating to entrepreneurial, because you start navigating like, okay, what are the problems that I could solve that maybe would really take off? And that's really what happened. It's as you work for a software company, you think about it, you're really solving problems for customers that want to spend money on something. And so when I first started off as a consultant, I was bouncing around the world, implementing software for customers and solving their problems. Then I took the job into product management, where product management is now I get to say what we build for the company. So that navigation from the consulting to product management was perfect. And now I'm really still solving customer problems, but I'm always looking for how can I be the best, be a really entrepreneurial and be something different that the competition doesn't have. And so today I work for SAP, which is a huge company based out of Germany that sells software. They've been selling software forever. It's, you know, they got about 100,000 employees, and they've given me budget and engineers to say, Manny, you go out and build the best product that you think that'll win us the deals in the market. So it's a cool job to have, where I still have that entrepreneurial spirit, even though I'm with a bigger company. But I did the startup thing a couple of times as well during right around the .com. And that was another level of type of entrepreneurial, but it was good as well. But I wanted to just go back and say that I really think that if you're somebody that just, especially like out of the Anderson School, that just really wants to solve problems and learn to be good at that, you would fit in perfectly here, because everything really leads to that. And then where you go from there could be entrepreneurial, could be anything else. But I sort of navigated into the entrepreneurial, and now I just love it, right? That's what I have to deal with every day, is how do I solve the next person's problem? And how can I do it and build that nice, shiny, cool thing that everybody would go, oh my God, that is so cool, I wanna buy it now.
That's great. And I'm with you, Manny. So I'm like at Adobe, any software, hardware, tech companies, that I think that's the key ingredient. Like, we're always hungry to solve problems and innovate, just like Ciara said. So I'm with you 100%. Irene, want to switch gears to you. So if you're thinking about just like your experiences of, you know, when you graduated from Anderson, what do you think nuggets of what you learned and experienced now that you'd want to kind of share with everybody else? Oh, you're on mute.
Figured that out at the same time you said that. That's a great question. Yeah, I think the problem solving that Manny mentioned, it's a really good question. So when I thought about this, I thought, what helped me make me successful? And the three things that came to mind immediately were, one, just basic tactical knowledge and management, like how to read a balance sheet, understand markets, manage people, organizations. I learned a lot of that back in the dark ages when I was at Anderson in the 80s. But and teamwork was the second thing. And I think somebody mentioned before the group projects. So the group projects at Anderson really set me up to work with all kinds of people. I mean, most degrees that you take, it's all theoretical, but the practical side of how Anderson was organized even back then with a lot of group projects and a lot of teamwork, that's the second thing. And the third thing is sort of the critical thinking, the problem solving, the entrepreneurial skills, the curiosity. And I got this from my professors, less so from the curriculum, but more so from the quality of the professors that I had, who really were, you know, they were passionate about us as students. And I think the same still holds true today with the professors I engage with today at Anderson. But they pushed me and they asked hard questions and they made me consider different ideas and approaches. And they taught me, Ciara, you mentioned observing and how to listen actively and how to be curious about things. And that was all really, really important. And what I think is really interesting is that each of these things kind of applied differently at different phases of my career, because I'm at the end of my career now. I have a few more years and then I'm at the sunset stage. So, you know, all that tactical knowledge was really helpful in my early days in my career. You know, just having that knowledge set me up to get jobs that were important. And I did a lot from that. And the teamwork really went throughout. I mean, you always need to work with teams, but it was really especially helpful when I started being in management roles, because not only being on great teams, which I had started at Anderson, I was able to form good teams from what I learned from that. And to me personally, there is nothing more rewarding than working on an excellent team and accomplishing something. And that's something we do here in Silicon Valley all the time. I feel so fortunate to have been on so many really like number one teams where we got it done and everybody contributed and it was really wonderful. And that all started with the teamwork at Anderson. And then lastly, kind of the critical thinking stuff, that's always applied as well, especially the active listening and the curiosity and the consideration of different ideas. But this part of my learning became really important when I moved into executive roles and I had more opportunities to participate in strategy setting and organizational design and working with these small startups that I advise today. You know, that stuff is all stuff that I learned a long time ago at Anderson that still holds true today, the basic tenets of problem solving and thinking through strategy and critical thinking and asking the right questions. I mean, it's a lot about formulating questions and listening to people's ideas. You know, you can't do it alone. So there were just a lot of important things that helped me get where I am today, but I'm grateful I had those experiences. But, you know, those three things, the tactical learning, the teamwork, and the critical thinking together, it's a powerhouse.
Excellent. So I hope you've heard a lot of those themes from our three main panelists so far. What I want to do now is transition to that second topic. How do we best keep our outside of New Mexico alumni connected to Anderson and really benefiting each other? And this is where I want to transition to Crystal, who has a very important role at Anderson. And I'm going to transition her so she can ask a few follow-up questions to Dean Montoya. So Crystal, please take it away.
Hello, everyone. I haven't talked in a while. My name is Crystal Collier. My title is technically Senior Operations Manager at Anderson. But what that means in my day-to-day is I oversee a lot of the external engagement and alumni relations. And I am a Lobo through and through. I've been here forever. Gary can attest to that. He's literally known me for almost my entire UNM career. So we go way back. But a couple things. So, you know, Dean Montoya started on July 1, and she often talks about what a heavy lift it's been for all of us, you know, doing all of this remotely and making lots of changes and innovation. And I like to say constantly that, like, we've been lifting super heavy and we're in super in shape, which is the best feeling. If you've been at UNM in any capacity, that problem solving is a common thread, right? Like that's what we do. It's always problem solving, and nothing has made more sense, whichever word I'm trying to say, than all of the things that Dean Montoya has brought to us. So I'm super thankful to have her as our leader. And I say all of that to say some of the opportunities that she has brought to our attention that we just have never capitalized on before is reaching outside of New Mexico. The silver lining to COVID is that now we know that we can, right? We can have these types of opportunities where we're talking to people outside of the state and engaging in a totally different level. So we have 7 ways to engage. And that's sort of the approach that we've taken is finding 7 concrete ways for our alumni and community members to engage with Anderson in ways that are meaningful to them. We really don't want to tell people how to engage. We want it to be something that matters to them. Otherwise, they're not going to put their heart into it, right? And so the 7 ways are giving. Clearly, we love that because we like to have resources. Serving on an advisory board, which I assume we will talk about. Mentoring. We started a mentorship program last summer for all of our undergraduate students. Hiring our alumni. Connecting us to your networks and opportunities. Helping us recruit. Gary will take that help as well. And then advising, we have a bunch of different opportunities to advise either small businesses or student competitions or judging, just so many ways to give back in different ways. Did you say I was going to ask Dean Montoya questions?
I'll get there. So okay. Yes, if it's okay, I just want you to kind of keep the show going. So there was a two-part question. I don't know if you have that one available. If not, I can read it out.
Please go for it.
Okay, that sounds good. So Dean Montoya, these are coming to you. So if we're thinking about everything that Crystal just said, of just making sure that looking at all the Anderson grads that are all around the country and, you know, obviously Northern California, what opportunities do you think do exist to really strengthen ties, right, between a lot of those region chapters and back to Anderson? That's part one. And then the second is, you know, what do you think alumni can do to support Anderson's plans and objectives?
Yeah, and thank you. Again, I think it's a great question, and undoubtedly a silver lining for us out of COVID has been this recognition that we can successfully engage outside of our backyard. And that, in fact, is a really major agenda for me. And that is what we need to do to lift Anderson onto the national stage, which we have every right to be. And so part of what that means is that we need to be of service to companies that are, of course, in New Mexico, but outside, and we need to engage our alum, many of whom are outside New Mexico. So things that we've done, just to give a few creative examples that really, I think, have legs and are win-win, and it's how we should continue doing it, is one of the things that Crystal mentioned was mentoring. So our students need mentors. You are inspiring to them as examples of what they hope to achieve. You're working at places that they wish they could get jobs, or you're creating your own companies, which are dreams of theirs, including since selling ice cream to dogs. So they want, you're that next step. Wherever you are in your career, there is someone that would be inspired by what you're doing. And that works incredibly well virtually. It works better virtually even for people that are local, because they don't have to drive to meet each other and they can figure out a time that works for them. So Crystal helped lead the development of a mentor program, and we have opportunities to expand that writ large. So that's an easy one. Another one that was sort of unexpected, and people assumed, well, I can't participate, which is that we've launched advisory boards for all of our programs. We should always have advisory boards because it keeps our programs current, relevant. It gives us that critical feedback that we need to make sure that we are developing the best and brightest. And sometimes it connects us to companies who want to sponsor those applied projects you all talked about, because it's much better to work on a real project than some fake made up thing in a book. So we have advisory board members that live outside Albuquerque and they're Zooming in to meetings. And we have a great example here in Irene. We have another in Southern California, I believe, that's on our marketing board. And so Crystal will share what boards exactly, what all boards we have. And these are for programs as well as initiatives. An example of initiative is we have a Women in Leadership initiative that is focused on supporting young women that are in school as they aspire to and begin to develop their careers, but also connecting professional women and working to continue to advance the representation of women in senior leadership and on boards. So those are just a couple of examples, but people can participate from elsewhere. And I'll give you another one. This is not on Crystal's list, but I just pitched this today because I was talking to the Secretary of Economic Development about film industry. And she said, well, you know, most of the internships are going to be in LA. Most of our students can't afford to go there. And I said, well, those are a bunch of assumptions. And so maybe they can't afford to go, but I'll bet we have alumni who live there who might host them. And so I have successfully built hosting programs for an intern to be able to come out of state because otherwise they may not be able to take it. Even if it's a paid internship, they can't afford the housing cost. So there are a million things we could do. As Crystal knows, one of the best things not to ask me to do is hatch ideas because I'll give you a million. And then there's expectation that we start tackling them. But I'm a big fan of we as a community are one, I'll tell you, Lobos are loyal. You're supportive. You're like a family. And I personally think there's really nothing that we can't do to help our students who we help at the level of one. We work with them individually to get them through, to inspire them, to light that fire so that you all can go be great because you're our proof points. You are what our students want to be. And we want to make sure we're sharing your stories. And so there's a ton of ways. And I'm open to ideas. Antonio has brought ideas to the table. And I look for patterns and things we can repeat and scale because that's what you do at a university. You work at the level of one, but we also do it at scale. So I'm open to your ideas if you have suggestions and we need your support philanthropically as well. And it's important for me to share that with you because our students have great financial need. That is the nature of our student body. Many of them are in school on the lottery scholarship, which has declined over the years since many of you were in school. It's about half of what it was relative to cost of tuition. And so they have financial need and it's important. And the cool project work that they get to do and to go travel to another city, that's what philanthropy helps support, is the enrichment in their education that's fundamental to creating that life-changing and transformative experience. So I encourage you to think about where UNM fits in your giving plans. And how you can make a difference in someone's life with a gift.
Thank you, Dean Montoya. I think a lot of those things resonate with even just this group. There's several of us on different boards, volunteering in those mentoring roles, sales judges, and you know, you name it, scholarship donations. So I think there's a plethora of opportunities for everyone to be involved. And I would just say, whichever one of those resonate with you, just jump in. Right? Raise your hand, get involved, and see where you can kind of carve out a little bit of extra of your time. So this, going back to the panelists, of all those things that Dean Montoya just said, what other ideas or suggestions might you have for both her and Crystal of just ways that we can continue to kind of support Anderson? This could be for anybody, whoever wants to take it first.
Well, I'll jump in.
Okay.
So I just love that there are already so many ways to stay involved, and I'm taking advantage of a couple of them already. I've done two semesters worth of mentoring for the students in the business school. It's extremely rewarding. Both the two students that I had were extremely different from each other, so the mentorships were very, very different and fun, and it's well organized and made it really easy on me, you know, from the perspective as a mentor. Everything was structured and set up and it was great. And then I'm sitting on the Entrepreneurship Advisory Board kind of as an outside voice, you know, outside of New Mexico kind of voice to bring some ideas and some thoughts in there. So that's where I'm taking my thoughts. So I don't have too many to say here that I'm not already feeding to Raj and the people on the entrepreneurship board. So making introductions is another one. And I think I would love to have, recruiting events, like with our NorCal chapter. You know, it's an opportunity to have people from the business school, people from other colleges too, come and meet our alum here. And they, you know, we have someone here who works at Facebook. We've got lots of people that work at big companies that hire interns, that look at other things. And I think there's potential opportunity for that.
Thank you, Irene. And I know just one of the examples of Sierra talking, I have some marketing students right now that would be very interested in connecting with her, with her agency. So that's a conversation after this.
Yes.
Anybody else want to jump in? Sierra, sounds like you do.
Actually, this is, so in one of the seven ways to engage, one of the ones that resonated with me was connect, right? And I think, Dean Montoya, you kind of briefly touched on this already, but in this COVID virtual world, one of the things that we've all realized that there is an ability to connect with people. And while though it's not the same in person, it actually still opens up so many other doors and possibilities. And one thing that the University of California at Berkeley just did was they created something called the Golden Bear Network. And it was a network for students and everybody who's ever gone there to network. And my husband told me about it, and I said, man, I wish we had that at UNM. And maybe there is that, and I don't know about it, but it goes back to that connection of not only mentoring and helping, but also getting those connections and staying connected on a professional level as well.
It's a great point, Sierra. I know there's always opportunities, I think, to create some of those groups. But I think with this alumni association, I know Margaret's on representing the main UNM Alumni Association. I think they're coming up with a lot of new ideas of how to create some of those connections as well, which is great.
Yeah.
So I want to be mindful of time. We've got about 9 minutes left. Please submit any other questions in the chat box. But I also want to go back to Manny. Any of your perspectives that you want to add based on what Dean Montoya and Crystal said?
I think all those ideas are just awesome. And I think for me, being in the Valley for 30 years, it's like, anything I can do to create that bigger pipe between that the people from UNM and to Silicon Valley just needs to be huge, and it just needs to be straight through. And entrepreneurship is doesn't necessarily have to be the part, but start with the interns, right? The intern jobs. I mean, we have tons of those at SAP. I mean, you wouldn't believe the number of kids that we get at SAP, these big companies from all over the world. I mean, it's like every summer, I could always tell at the cafeterias at SAP, oh, you can see that all the Germans are over there and the people from Mexico and Brazil. And I just wish there was a group there from New Mexico, all of them with their UNM hats on and such. But we need to make that and let the students know, especially now with COVID. Now, you could possibly work from New Mexico and still work, you know, even though you're not at SAP in Silicon Valley. But huge opportunities. They're right there if you just go look at those internship websites, and they just create tons of opportunity. And once you get in there, I'm telling you, you'll just never want to leave in that whole technology world. It just opens up so many other doors.
Agreed. Very good. Thank you, Manny. So at this point, I want to make sure that everybody hopefully has a chance to look at our final poll. So we do have one, and that should pop up here in a second. So if you can, please respond to that. And while that's coming up, I just wanted to just check from everybody now if anybody has any specific questions that they want to ask of any of the speakers.
Yeah, I wanted to mention that I've been living out in the Bay Area in San Francisco since, 40 years. And I did go to UNM Law School, but then I came back here and then I went to school again. And now I have a son who's 26 and he works at Google. And my nephew, I'm here because my nephew, who is a UNM student and he's president of the NASA Society and Association and et cetera, he wanted to come, but he just was like, oh, could you come with me? Then he thought, well, they're not going to want to hear from me. But I think that we now have intergenerational connections that can be made. Like my son, who's at Google, would love to talk to someone at UNM Anderson School of Business to see if we could open up internships, especially for, you know, students who might not otherwise have access to some of the tools that other students have. So I just wanted to thank you all for letting me join your group today.
Of course. Thank you, Joe. That's a great comment. So Crystal, I think you've heard a lot of that same theme of hopefully that we're getting, you know, some stronger connections with a lot of the different corporate and entrepreneurial kind of opportunities. Well, what would you suggest, like in terms of those making those stronger connections?
Any ideas that you all have, please email me. I might not be the person, but I know the person, and Antonio and Irene have seen this happen where it's just like, what do you think about this? And then we just have to get the right people in the room to figure out how to best make it happen. I do, before we end, want to just give you all the list, because we've been very busy with advisory board. So just to give you an idea of which ones we have on deck, we started these all since January. We have Sales Center, Women in Leadership, Finance, Marketing, Entrepreneurship, Human Resources, Information Systems, and we are currently working on a Business for Good, or a B Corp advisory board, as well as restructuring our accounting advisory board. So that is 9.
And I believe there's a link to an interest form on that website. Yes. That Crystal put in the chat box, so you can click which one may be of interest to learn more information. And to Joe's point, I just want to comment that if you have any introductions you would like to make for us to hiring managers or HR departments, that's the pathway for us to get our students started down the process of internships. If your company has a foundation and you have any recommendations or connections you can make to your foundation, we qualify for a lot of what many corporate foundations are focused on because of our strengths in terms of diverse pipeline. And that applies to, of course, what goes on here at the university, but some companies are also investing in K-12 initiatives to move students into STEM or entrepreneurial endeavors. We can play a role in that. And we also can play a role in K-12 or community initiatives around financial literacy. So there are just really many things that we can be engaged in. If something just strikes you as an idea and say, hey, maybe you should check this out, please shoot Crystal a note and we'll figure out if it's something that we can respond to, partner on, engage in. But we appreciate the connections through your network. That's incredibly valuable for us.
I want to ditto that. I mean, I think it's so great that you guys are open. And I just think, sitting here in Silicon Valley, and I work in this emerging field of customer success, and it's got, it's growing like crazy. Like, you know, in the last 5 years, the number of jobs in customer success went from a couple hundred to a couple million. And so it's a field where there's a ton of hiring and there's a ton of stuff going on. And, there's a potential there, and I'm working with Raj on it. You know, I've made some introductions with some other certification programs and things like that. But the diversity that, I just want to reinforce what you said, Dean Montoya, because the diversity is so important to Silicon Valley companies in particular. Hate to say it, but we do not have good diversity in Silicon Valley companies today. It is a lot of white men in the staff for the most part, and there's a huge opportunity there to, you know, make that connection with UNM, bring more diversity to these companies, bring more jobs to UNM graduates, and make those connections. I hope we can do something with it.
Just real quickly, thank you, Irene. I want to answer real quickly Gary's question. So I just joined the board for Rainforest. And so the things that we have planned there relate to some of our partnerships with engineering to do soft landing and support for scaling of companies. So those are, and also in partnership with the national labs. Those are early days of development of programs that we're working on, but we also partner with Innovation Academy, which Rob Del Campo, an Anderson faculty member, leads. And so that's all connected to Anderson by way of Rob, in terms of offering training and coursework around entrepreneurship. And then Rainforest would be space, workspace and living space as well for someone who is starting a company. So that's in, it's always been the case, but we're working to ramp up some new things that will be some, I think, exciting ideas for scaling firms.
Excellent. Thank you, Gary, for the question. And that's exciting, Dean Montoya. I'm really glad to see a lot of the innovation there. So I want to be mindful of time. We've got 1 minute to go. I want to finish on time, or relatively as close to time. So what I want to do is switch gears over to Margaret Ortega, who is representing the alumni office. And for any alumni, they're going to either be on here or listen later. There's some exciting things coming up in September. Margaret, what is that?
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Antonio. Thank you, everyone, for being here today and participating in this great conversation. I just wanted to mention that many of our regional chapters, including our NorCal chapter, plan for green chili roasts every year. Last year, unfortunately, due to COVID, we could not have our chili roast. So we're all going to cross our fingers and hopefully get out to California. Everyone's invited to join. We'll all meet up in Silicon Valley and have a great green chili roast. These green chili roasts serve not only to get local alumni together, but also serve as a purpose to fundraise for the many chapter scholarships that exist. The NorCal chapter does have an endowed scholarship. So each year they award students a scholarship award, maybe one, two, three students, depending each year. But it's a great opportunity to participate in the philanthropy aspect, as was has been mentioned a few times earlier. So whether you're in California or all the way to DC, look out this fall. We really, really hope we'll continue the in-person green chili roast events, and you can visit unmalumni.com for more information, and hopefully we'll all have more information soon about fall and in-person gatherings resuming.
Very good, Margaret, thank you so much. And just want to wrap up there and just thank our whole panel, Dean Montoya, Crystal, Ciara, Manny, and Irene. I appreciate everybody joining today, and I hope everybody has a great afternoon. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
And then there were three.